In today's video, I want to talk to you guys about three issues that I have with the Robinhood app that I really wish they would address, hopefully by sometime in 2020. Let's get into this. What's up, everyone? My name is Ale. Welcome back to my world of stocks. Okay, now I don't want to sound like I'm just bashing Robinhood, so let me just quickly run through a couple positives that I really like about Robinhood. Now, as of recording this video, I am not sponsored by Robinhood, nor have I ever been, and I don't even give out my referral code because I don't want to sound overly biased. So as it stands, I really have no personal or financial reasons to be praising Robinhood, but I can't really help but doing so because of everything that they've done for the community. Now, yes, of course, we are now starting to see large brokerages like TD Ameritrade and Charles Schwab and E-Trade and others offering commission-free trading, but it's really a result of what Robinhood has already been doing for a while, and it's a result of Robinhood stealing a lot of their customers, myself included. You guys might remember that I used to do the majority of my investing on E-Trade, and I still do use E-Trade for some things, but the majority of my investing is now done through Robinhood because the offering of commission-free trading was just too enticing for me to ignore. Now, as you guys know, I'm a long-term investor, and you guys also know that I like to do the majority of my buying when stocks are actually going down rather than when they're going up. So as a result of that, I practice a lot of dollar cost averaging. I pick up stocks little by little in small amounts over time as they continue to drop. So if I see a stock drop 5% and I think it might drop another 5% potentially, then it may not make sense to go all in on that stock right away. It might make more sense to buy it slowly in small amounts as it continues to drop. But the result of that is that I end up with a lot of different transactions, and those can quickly add up if I'm constantly being charged $7 to $10 as a fee for every stock trade that I make. So having commission-free trading was a no-brainer for me. And another thing that I really liked about Robinhood was just the simplicity of the application. Now, that's not as huge of a deal for me because I am an experienced investor and I can work my way through other platforms, and I have well before Robinhood. But what I like about the simplicity of the Robinhood app is that I can tell a lot of my friends and family about investing, and I can tell them that all they really have to do is just download this application and they can invest in great giant companies without having to pay any fees. And it's very simple to just sign up and instantly become a part owner of Microsoft or Google or Apple or anything else. And so that's very powerful because it convinces a lot of beginners to finally take the plunge and actually invest their money rather than wasting it on things that don't really matter that much in life. So anyway, those are some big pros. And if those weren't enough pros as it is, another thing that I really like about Robinhood is that they are now revamping their Robinhood Cash Management. They tried to launch it in the past, but they've had issues, but now they're relaunching it. And so any money that you have in your Robinhood account will earn you over 2%. That is subject to variable rates, but it's also FDIC insured, and you get a MasterCard debit card to use for purchases or withdrawals, which I think is pretty cool and can also entice people to be putting their money into Robinhood. And if they're not quite ready to buy stocks, they're still at least earning some interest. And then when they are ready, they can invest in these great companies and potentially earn even more money over the long term. So again, I'm a big fan of Robinhood, but I still think that there are three key issues that should be addressed. And coming in at number one, that's going to be the lack of fractional shares. Now, if you're not familiar with fractional shares, that's where you can essentially buy a stock, but you can buy like a small piece of a share. So for example, think of something like Amazon or Google. Amazon trades for close to $2,000 a share. Google trades for over $1,000 a share. Those are expensive on a share price basis. Now, that does not reflect their valuation. These companies could still be incredibly undervalued, but their share price is very high, just kind of in general terms. So you take a beginner in the stock market and they look at these great companies, maybe like even Microsoft or Apple, that trade for hundreds of dollars a share, and it's going to encourage bad investing decisions if they look at those stocks and it's going to cost them hundreds of dollars just to start investing in them. While on the other hand, you could pick up these other stocks that trade for maybe $30, $20 a share, $10, $5, or even less. And they look at those and they think, well, it's very easy for me to dollar cost average with those. It's really easy for me to just continuously add to my portfolio. I can take my monthly budget or my weekly budget, and I can actually afford to buy these stocks because their share prices are so low. But maybe not, like maybe somebody's monthly budget doesn't even afford them one share of Amazon. And Amazon might be a great company. It might be a company that you should absolutely hold in your portfolio as a core position, but because it trades for close to $2,000 a share, your monthly budget might not even be able to afford you that. So it might take you a long time just to accumulate, just to save up enough money just to be able to afford Amazon. And that's fine if you want to do that and you can do that, but what I'm trying to get at is that I think subconsciously, I think a lot of beginners in the market with low budgets look at these cheaper stocks and they're encouraged to just be buying these stocks that trade for lower share prices because it's so much easier to just continuously add to their position. If you buy, I don't know, General Electric, and General Electric might be highly speculative, it might be a bad company to invest in, but you see your position in General Electric, maybe you only have a couple shares, maybe it continuously drops, maybe it turns into a falling knife and keeps crashing, which is actually the case with what happened with GE in the past. But anyway, it's really easy for you to just add to your position because you see a drop 10% and you're like, well, it's only, you know, 10 bucks a share or whatever. It's easy for me to just buy more shares and lower my cost basis. And you might just kind of subconsciously keep adding to your position. And before you know it, you have this pretty large position in General Electric because you've been buying it slowly over time, but you're not picking up these other great companies like Microsoft, for example, that you should absolutely be buying like on any dip, and you just don't because the share price is kind of too high and your monthly budget can't really afford it, and you don't like to just keep your money on the sidelines and just wait and save until you can't afford it. So by having fractional shares, I think it'll just encourage smarter investing. I think people will focus more on how good the company is, what are their fundamentals, and they'll look at those things and not care so much about just the individual share price. If your monthly budget is only $100 and you want to just put that into Amazon, well, you can pick up a fractional share worth $100 and all of a sudden you're invested in Amazon, and every time that it drops and you see more attractive prices, you can still continue to invest in it rather than picking up all of these highly speculative stocks. And they might not even be speculative. Yeah, some good companies might trade at lower share prices. That's fine. But I think at the end of the day, some people might realize when they look at their portfolio after a long period of time that they ended up with some more speculative stocks just because their monthly budgets didn't allow them to be investing in great companies that happens to be trading at higher share prices. So anyway, that might be a little confusing for some of you, but overall, I just think that adding fractional shares can encourage smarter investing. So that's issue number one. Okay, moving on to issue number two. This is going to do entirely with the way that Robinhood handles dividends. Now, on a small scale, something that I don't think is that big of a deal, but can still be very frustrating for a lot of us, is the way that they report dividend yields and how Robinhood almost always gets them wrong. Here's the dividend listed for a popular dividend stock called AbbVie, and Robinhood lists their yield as 4.285%, but when looking at Seeking Alpha, we can see that it's actually closer to 6%, and if you think that's bad, take a look at Macy's, who Robinhood reports as having a dividend yield of 5.869%, but when checking Seeking Alpha, we can see that it's much closer to 10%. And if you think that's a huge difference, take a look at General Electric, who Robinhood lists as having a dividend yield of close to 5%, and that's obviously a huge dividend, right? Well, unless you've been living under a rock, you probably know that GE famously cut their dividend all the way down to just a penny, leaving them with a yield of less than 0.5%. Again, that's not a huge deal. We can get the accurate information elsewhere, and from what I've seen, they do still pay you out the correct amounts, but it can still be frustrating, especially if you're someone who likes to just kind of browse stocks on Robinhood, and you might come across a stock like GE and see that it has a really big dividend yield, and you think to yourself, huh, that's an interesting stock. I should look deeper into that one. I should add it to my watch list and research it further, only to discover later on that that dividend almost entirely doesn't even exist. Now, something that I think a lot of people would consider to be a bigger issue is that Robinhood doesn't offer DRIP, which is a dividend reinvestment plan. And if you're not familiar with what DRIP is, it's basically a plan that you sign up for that automatically reinvests the cash that you receive from dividends back into the stock as additional shares or even fractional shares if it's not enough to buy full shares. This is great if you want a more hands-off approach to investing and want to compound your dividend gains into a bigger and bigger position in a company that will yield more dividend money in the future. Personally, I don't really care that much about DRIP because I like to reinvest my dividend money into the specific stocks that I find attractive at that time, but that's more of a hands-on approach rather than what some other people might like, which is more of a hands-off approach. Also, you have to consider that many companies offer DRIP plans where they give you the shares at a discount as well, so that can also be a benefit. And this is still considered taxable income that you do have to report unless it's held in a tax-advantaged account like an IRA. But that of course brings me to issue number three, which is that Robinhood doesn't offer tax advantaged accounts or retirement accounts. And I might as well add that you also can't diversify into bonds either. Now, if you're not familiar with what a Roth IRA is or what some of its advantages are, that's where you can invest money that you pay taxes on now so that you don't have to pay taxes on it later. And on top of that, it also offers you tax-free growth, meaning that if you were to invest in Amazon in a Roth IRA and say quadruples, well, all of those profits are not going to be taxed either. So it's actually a huge benefit. And then when looking at bonds, those can be beneficial as well because a lot of people consider bonds to be a safer way of investing because they're kind of like loans. You essentially get your money back at maturity, but you've also been collecting coupons, which are sort of like dividends. So you've been collecting more money on top of that. And as long as you are buying bonds from well-run companies or governments, there's a very low chance that they're gonna go bankrupt and not pay you your money back. So that's why you often hear a lot of people say that you shouldn't just invest in stocks, but that you should also diversify into other things like bonds and other asset classes as well. Now, granted, you could get tax-advantaged accounts and bonds and other things through other brokerages, but I think it would be nice to just at least have the option of getting kind of everything in one place on Robinhood if you want that. So if you want those things on Robinhood, you can do that. If you don't trust Robinhood, you want to go through another brokerage, well, then you can do that too. I think just having the option would be beneficial. I think it would be a positive. So anyway, those are the top three issues that I have. Now, there are just a couple more bonus ones that I'll just quickly mention. And number one, that's going to be the fact that Robinhood isn't that great of a platform for day traders or short-term traders because it doesn't really have a robust platform for technical analysis. Now, for me, that doesn't really matter as much because I'm more of a fundamental long-term investor, but I can understand why short-term traders do have issues with Robinhood and it wouldn't be their platform of choice. And then bonus issue number two is going to be that I don't believe they offer telephone support at this time. I've seen a lot of people complain about that, and they do actually offer email support. And this is anecdotal, but in my experience, I've had a lot of success just going through email. They were very friendly and very helpful, so I haven't had an issue with that. But I can see how either beginners who have a lot of questions or even more experienced traders that do more complex trades, they may have questions that they want answered in real time by an actual person that they can speak to over the phone. So I can understand why that's a frustration. It's just not that big of a deal for me personally, but maybe that's something that they can add in the future. Okay, so anyway, those are going to be the main issues that I have with Robinhood that I wish that they would at least address and work on a little bit, hopefully sometime in 2020. But if there's anything that I left out, make sure you leave it down below in the comment section. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, make sure you hit the like button. Really helps support the channel. And I'll catch you guys in the next one. Thanks for all the support. Take care. Bye-bye.